Druid Mystic, a new adult urban fantasy novel, the Colin McCool series, Book 10. Written by M.D. Massey. Narrated by Stephen Barnett. Chapter 1. I sensed something wasn't right as I exited the back door to Luther's Cafe with a 20-ounce mocha latte in one hand and a red eye in the other. The mocha was for me. Finnegas wouldn't be caught dead drinking bougie crap like that. And the other beverage was for the old man. A red eye was an Americano on steroids. 16 ounces of coffee served black, with a double espresso poured in for good measure. The old druid might as well have been snorting Adderall, considering the caffeine content, but I wasn't about to scold a 2,000-year-old seer for his stimulant habit. Besides, the coffee was a necessity at this point. We'd run out of the good stuff at the junkyard, and both of us were tired and frazzled from having to tie up all our affairs over a 3-day period. After my duel with Yarmwood, in which I stabbed the demigod through the eye and made a permanent enemy of his foster father Angus, Maeve had ordered me to leave town until things blew over. For the last 3 days, Finnegas and I had been running ourselves ragged, preparing for an extended trip abroad. It all felt way too much like adulthood for my tastes, even though I had the old man and Maureen to help take care of the details. Of course, I wasn't too keen on leaving my adopted hometown and all my friends behind. But no matter how I felt about it, the bottom line was that we couldn't stay in Austin. Finnegas tried to play it off.
"We'll be back before you know it," he'd said. "Just look at this as a sort of extended vacation."
Vacation, right. We're dealing with gods here. Those fuckers can hold a grudge for centuries. Hell, I might never be able to come home. I pushed the thought from my mind, choosing instead to address the hidden danger that had the hairs on my neck standing up. With a sigh, I backstepped so I could set the coffees on the hood of a nearby car, tripping as my foot caught on a crack in the concrete. Just as I stumbled backwards to prevent a fall, my mocha sprouted a leak and hot coffee spurted all over my hand. "Fuck!" I yelled as I dropped the cups, simultaneously turning my stumble into an awkward reverse roll that took me behind Luther's late model Miata. Shaking the liquid from my scalded hand, I glanced at the discarded receptacles. Mine had a slender, nearly horizontal gash on both sides near the top of the cup. Shit, I don't have time for this. I glanced behind me, where 3 throwing knives were embedded, one right next to the other in a red brick wall. Only Fae smiths made blades that could easily pierce brick and stone, a fact that instantly cast suspicion on the identity of my attackers. The voice that called out to me from some as-yet-unrevealed hiding spot proved my hunch right.
"The deadline has passed, Druid," the bright, clear male voice sang as 2 more throwing knives embedded themselves in the Mazda's trunk lid. "And you are now trespassing in the Queen's demesne." High Fae never yelled, or hollered, or shouted. Their mellifluous voices wouldn't allow it. Instead, they sang like angels when they raised their voices, although they were anything but. The Fae assassin's words floated like a bird's song across the parking lot, a pleasing melody of syllables marred by that particular tone of dismissal and contempt that only the Ausitha could muster.
"Damn it, Eliandres, I still have 6 hours!" An arrow whizzed overhead in response, sinking almost to the fletching in the grassy earth beyond as it hit. I quickly calculated angles of trajectory, determining that the knife thrower was hidden a few feet above ground level while the archer had posted on a nearby rooftop.
"Not by our count," his female companion replied. "The queen gave you 3 days. The 3rd day ended at sundown, which passed 1/4 human hour ago. Your life is now forfeit."
I scowled, even though I was pretty sure they couldn't see it.
"The hell you say! That's not how we tell time here in Texas."
"Her words were clear," Eliandres chimed in reply.
"Quite clear," Lucindra added. Wait just one flippin' minute, I protested. You two are going to kill me just because I didn't leave town on time?
Oh, Druid, kill is such a droll word, the female fae replied. We prefer to call it permanent expatriation. Doesn't that sound so much better?
It does, Lucindras, her male accomplice smugly replied.
And Maeve is okay with this? I asked.
Yes, in a manner of speaking, said Eliandres. My voice dripped with sarcasm as I responded, digging in my craneskin bag all the while.
So you're saying she didn't expressly sanction this hit?
Their silence told me all I needed to know. Fae could bend the truth like no one's business, but they would never speak falsely due to a pact made with mankind long, long ago. That's why it was possible to cheat a fae creature by forcing it into a situation in which it could tell neither the truth nor a lie. I didn't personally know of anyone who'd done so, of course. That shit only happened in the kind of fairy tales you told to kids. The best I could hope for was a short breather while they figured out how to twist the truth to suit their ends. While they were busy getting their story straight, I screwed a suppressor onto the barrel of my Glock. Earlier, I'd loaded it with iron-tipped ammo in anticipation of running into a Tua assassin. When I grabbed those magazines this morning, little did I suspect it'd be my own team coming after me. Well, more or less. Maeve was as much an enemy as an ally, and I could never be certain as to whose side she was on. Still, I seriously doubted she wanted me dead. Lucindras was the first to break the silence.
The Queen allows us a certain amount of discretion, Eliandres continued without missing a beat, regarding how we execute the duties of our unique positions in her court. Eliandres paused before continuing, and I sagely chose not to interrupt. I needed to prepare a few spells anyway, so the more they blathered on, the better.
We're currently following standard operating procedure, which allows for the use of deadly force to remove dangerous supernatural entities who trespass on the Queen's lands.
Done. Time to call their bluff and flush them out.
Maeve doesn't know you two are hunting me, does she? Don't tell me. You've been avoiding her for the past few days, denying her the opportunity to expressly forbid you from killing me.
Perhaps we might have failed to show our faces at court lately, Lucindras purred.
But we can assure you it has nothing to do with a desire to skirt the Queen's command, Eliandres added.
You fuckers sure know how to hold a grudge, you know that?
Our personal feelings have nothing to do with it, Druid, Lucindras said. This is simply business and nothing more.
By that time, I had already cast my first spell. It was one of many Finnegas and I had been working on since my fight with Djarmwood Uaduvna, the Tua demigod otherwise known as Dermot O'Dyna. That fucker had kidnapped my girlfriend, and when I'd finally defeated him, it turned out to be a Pyrrhic victory. I'd slain Djarmwood after the fight, but only after he'd left me permanently wounded and unable to shift into my Fomorian form. And believe me, I'd tried. Since the wounds caused by Djarmwood only appeared when I shifted, I'd spent plenty of time in the grove experimenting with shifting into the part-human, part-Fomorian form I'd used in the past. In that form, my internals were Fomorian, while my skin and shape appeared human, which was why I thought it might work. But nope. I'd nearly died from internal bleeding when I tried it. Oops. Thus, I'd have to face the twin assassins in my fully human form. I'd done it before, back when I still had limited control over my so-called warp spasm, my Fomorian shifter abilities. But the two had underestimated me on that occasion, and in truth, it was luck and treachery as much as skill that allowed me to escape our first encounter relatively unharmed. It was highly doubtful they'd make the same mistake twice. I also suspected that they were well aware that I couldn't shift, giving them both a physical and psychological advantage over me. But I had one thing working in my favor. The last time I'd fought them, I wasn't the same Druid. While I was still second-rated wielding magic.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.